So, we have seen that our lambda point estimator, if we just plot it one more time, let's recall it. So we have seen that the point estimator for lambda using this Farmer-Macbeth regressions is this guy here. Yeah, we see that the intercept term is 0.26, and the risk premium associated with the market factor is 0.55, or rounded 0.56. The risk premium for the size factor, or the risk premium associated with the size factor, is 0.35% per month. It's in monthly terms. And the risk premium for the value factor, the cross-sectional risk premium, is minus 0.64% per month. The corresponding t-statistic using our Farmer-Macbeth regressions approach, we have found in the code here. Yeah, so we have to divide the point estimator, the corresponding point estimator, divided by this square root of the variance, of the corresponding variance of these time-varying lambda, divided by the number of observations. Yeah, it's a plain formula for the t-statistic. Yeah, and again, we know we have to compare the corresponding value of the t-statistic with the critical values of the normal distribution, that is minus 1.96, respectively 1.96. Yeah, and we have seen that whenever, whatever we do here, yeah, if we take like the first guy, if we take the lambda of one, yeah, divided by the square root of the variance of lambda, the corresponding time varying lambda, which is in the first row of our lambda matrix, yeah, divided by the number of observations. There's something wrong going on here, obviously. So let's see. So the corresponding t-statistic of the intercept term is 0.72, or rounded 0.73. Yeah, so which indicates that the unexplained part of our expected return vector y underscore expected, the unexplained part is statistically not different from zero, which would mean actually that our model performs well in explaining the variation in expected returns, yeah, in the cross-sectional expected returns. So that's of course not very likely, because we know from the time series framework that the GRS test rejects the null hypothesis that the alphas are jointly zero. Yeah, and we talked about that we have some problems here with this methodology, especially the way how we implemented it. So we know that the betas are time varying, and this approach that we have here, in that we discussed here, does not take this into account. Yeah, that's the problem. So what we would like to do now is we would like to implement the time varying Farmer-Macbeth regressions. Yeah, so let's implement the time varying approach. Yeah, Farmer-Macbeth regressions, time-varying betas. And this is something that we can easily do in MATLAB, but of course, standard programs do not offer this, but it's easy to code. Yeah. So how do we proceed? So let's define the length of our time series, which is the length of y11. And remember, in y11, we have stored our test assets, and we want to have 25 test assets, right? Just check it one more time here in our workspace, y11. Yes, it's 497, a T by N matrix, yeah? 497 by T is T, and N is 25, yeah? And actually, we have already determined the length of y11, so the T should be 497, and it should be still, yeah, in the workspace. So actually, we don't need to do it. This step is actually redundant, but let's do it just for that we have everything in order. And the 25, and actually we have this also in our workspace already, so we don't have to define it again. Okay, 3. Now let's say we use 60 months. Yeah, age is 60. This is our time, our rolling time window. Yeah, this is common practice. You usually always use 60, a time window of 60 months to estimate the beta. Yeah, using our Farmer Macbeth regressions, you get the point estimator for your lambda vector. Yeah, and you stack it into a matrix. Yeah, basically same thing that we did earlier. Yeah, like here. Yeah, we defined a matrix lambda where we stored in our results, but this matrix has now it's now shorter. It's now t minus h observations wide. Yeah, so k plus one is obviously the row dimension. Yeah, and we want to stack our point estimates in each column, and we have capital T columns. But since we have now a rolling time window of 60 months, and we have to get started somewhere, we lose 60 observations. So this matrix here becomes then t minus h. Yeah, so we store our corresponding point estimates given each time window in a matrix lambda that has the dimension k plus 1 by t minus h. Yeah, so let's do that. Let's construct the zero matrix first, where we store in our results. So lambda is now zeros, k plus 1 like earlier, because we have three, we have k regressors and an intercept term, and t capital T minus h, because we lose the first 60 observations, right? So, and obviously you can do different time windows. Yeah, most papers, as far as I'm concerned, use 60 months, but there are also, of course, different. You can use 100 months, you can use whatever. But you have to have somehow a justification for what you do. And obviously in the literature, there's a sort of consensus achieved that 60 observations is enough to have some stability in your statistical inference. So then we operate with a for loop. Yeah. So we do something capital T minus H times. So for T is from 1 until capital T minus H. Yeah. What do we do? So let's first define our submatrix. So we want to have now we want to have h observations in each iteration. Yeah, the first we want to have h rows from our y11 matrix. Yeah, because we want to condition our estimation upon the time window of 60 observations. So let's define a matrix y111 is equal to y11, and in y11 we have our 25 test assets in and the excess returns in capital T rows. In each iteration T, we want to have the rows T until T plus H minus 1. Yeah. And we want to have all columns, yeah, because we want to have the whole risk factor set, the whole set of test assets, right? So if T is 1 in the first iteration, yeah, so it gets you the observations 1 until 1 plus 60 minus 1, so 1 until 60, yeah, of that matrix of test assets. If we go to iteration 2, if T is 2, it takes then the observations 2 until 61. So this guy is again a 60. This is it's 60 by n matrix in each iteration, of course. Yeah. So also we want to have the corresponding regressors that are time congruent to this matrix of test assets. Yeah, logically. So we define it as, so an x1 in our workspace is already defined as the as a T by 4 matrix. So we have already here once in the first column, so we don't have to define it separately. We can just define that which time dimension we want to retrieve, and of course the same like here, so we can just copy it. Yeah, we have the same congruent dimension of the risk factor matrix that we want to retrieve in each iteration. So we start with the actual estimation. So our beta is equal to zeros, yeah, same thing like before, n by k. And actually we can now copy part of the code, obviously. So let's go back, let's copy this guy here. We can copy this, put it in here. And now we just have to remember, this is now our y111, yeah, x1 we have already defined, so we can take this away. Constants we don't need either. Oh, x1 matrix is defined here, and it's now x1 that we use here. x11, yeah, because the x matrix always changes in each iteration depending on where we are in the sample. And anyways, this is always overwritten in each iteration, so we know this already. And this is the same thing like earlier. Yeah. So we first perform here, given we have this current time span or time window, conditional on this current time window, we perform for each stock equation by equation OLS regression. Yeah. Same thing that we did before. Yeah. First, we have the time series regressions. We get the data, we get the estimated betas, we stack them into a matrix, we add a vector of ones. So this is now what happens. Yeah. So that's, we can copy also the second part, obviously, then of the code. So we can copy this guy here. Copy it here to the new code. This is the same thing. Our constants one, so this guy here, this is what we have denoted as constant one, is a vector of ones that has the dimension according to our test assets. And we have 25 test assets, so that's the same thing. So beta one is now this guy here, yeah, this matrix. So it's defined as constant, and this matrix, the submatrix that where we have stored the corresponding point estimates for our betas here, for our 25 stocks. Our vector y underscore expected, which is the conditional on the current rolling time window. It's the vector of expected returns for our 25 assets, so it's a 25 by 1 vector, and each entry is the sample average of this 60 time series observations of excess returns for each single asset. Yeah, so this is now conditional on the current rolling time window that we investigate. So this is obviously also changing across time, of course. So then we have our lambda here. Yeah, this is our point estimator that we have here. Yeah, this standard formula. And this point estimator changes now in each iteration. Yeah, and we stack it always into this matrix here. After each iteration, we stack it here. So this should be then, let's see how it should look like. So this is then lambda. Our lambda in column T, yeah, in all rows, yeah, and we know we have four rows in each column of lambda, of our lambda matrix, and we want to put in the current estimated lambda, yeah, this guy here, and this is overwritten in each observation, in each iteration. This guy here is overwritten, but luckily we store it here in this lambda matrix that we created here. And of course we have to put it before the first for loop. Yeah. Otherwise this guy here, if you put it in, it would be always overwritten in the code. Yeah. And we don't want that. I made this mistake earlier when I started with MATLAB in my mid-20s, obviously long time ago. But yeah, you learn of obviously as you do and you proceed with your skills. So we end the loop. So now it's obviously very simple code, basically. Now, if you know what you do, it's simple. If you don't know what you do, you have no clue what's going on here. So obviously, check if everything is correct. So this loop ends here. This lands on line 481. This line ends here, this ends here. Okay, it should be correct. So let's run the code, copy it. Yes, and I guess it works. So let's plot the time varying lambda. So let's plot the first, in the first row of our lambda matrix. Let's just check how it looks like. Let's go to lambda. It's now overwritten. It obviously now has the new entries. We have overwritten the previous code. Now here we have a 4 by 437 matrix. Earlier we had to remember we had a 4 by 497 matrix. Yeah, so we lose 60 observations here in the end. Let's double click. So what we see here in the first row of this matrix here, yeah, here we have obviously the corresponding time varying alpha, the corresponding time varying estimates for the intercept term, right? That's what we have. Then in the second row of our lambda matrix, we have the corresponding time varying estimates for the risk premiums for the corresponding that are associated with the market factor, right? Because, you know, in this regression, we had the corresponding beta exposures for the against the market factor. Yeah, and we have in the third column, in the third row, the time varying risk premiums associated with the size factor, and in the last row, we have the corresponding time varying risk premiums with the value factor. Yeah, so we can just plot. Let's plot the time varying risk premium of the intercept term, which is the first entry. This is what we get. So there's obviously a huge time variation going on here in the data. Yeah. So we have also, we can also plot the time varying risk premium for the market factor, which is this guy here. And also for the size factor we have here. And of course also the corresponding risk premium for the value factor, which we have here. So what we can do next is we can estimate the corresponding t-statistic. First of all, if you take the mean of this lambda of the first row, yeah, we get the corresponding unexplained part, yeah, from that model. So the 0.25 percent per month of this vector of expected returns, cross-sectional expected returns, cannot be explained by that model. Yeah, earlier you remember we had a value of 0.27. Now it's 0.25, so we have a different, slightly lower value. Second, the mean of this guy here. Yeah, if you take the mean of the second row, we get the corresponding risk premium associated with the market factor, and it's 0.46. Yeah, using our new approach here with time varying betas, and earlier we had 0.56. Yeah, so it's also slightly lower point estimate. Then the next one for the size factor, we had earlier 0.35% as risk premium for the size factor, and here we have 0.18 in this framework. And finally, the risk premium for the value factor, it's the last row here in our lambda matrix, yeah, the sample average, the mean, and it's minus 0.25. 28. And earlier we had minus 0.64. Yeah, so we have slightly lower estimates. But we are interested in mostly, or not mostly, but we are interested in the t-statistic, and we know already how to do that. The t-statistic is the mean. For instance, lambda 1, so for the first, so for the intercept term, so divided by what? The square root of the variance, what is in the first row here, yeah, of the time varying lambda, divided by t minus h, yeah, and we close the parentheses of the square root here as well. So we can copy this. What we get is the corresponding t statistic of this intercept term that we had here estimated our 0.25. Yeah. So our t statistic, yeah, the t statistic for this guy, which is 0.25, yeah, which is the again, which is the unexplained part by this model, yeah, is 7.26. Yeah, in our earlier model, we had a t-statistic of 0.73, and we would conclude that the model can explain the cross-section of expected returns. But now, our point as our new model with time-varying betas has a point estimate of 0.25, and the corresponding t-statistic is 7.26, which means that on a 5% level, yeah, or actually at any level, yeah, this model cannot explain the cross-section of expected returns, the cross-sectional variation of expected returns. Yeah. So this is an important implication. This is now, we have now the same result, basically, or at least qualitatively, the same result as in the time series framework. Because you remember, when we implemented the GRS test, we concluded that the alphas are jointly statistically different from zero, implying that in the time series framework, the three-factor model from Palmer and French cannot price the cross-section of returns correctly, or test assets correctly. But we now here, we use now the cross-sectional variation of average returns, and we see we have the same result, namely that the Palmer and French three-factor model cannot explain the cross-section of expected returns. Yeah, because the intercept term, which measures the part that remains unexplained of the cross-sectional average returns, is 0.25% per month. And the t-statistic indicates that this unexplained part is statistically significant on any level. Hence, we conclude that the Palmer-French three-factor model is not able to price these test assets that we have in our universe here correctly. So we can do the same thing. We can also estimate the t-statistic for the market factor. Yeah, what we have now is a t-value of 12.5. Yeah, again, we remember that we had a sample that our risk premium was 0.46% per month. Yeah, and this is statistically significant on any level. Yeah, because 12 is much, much larger than our critical value of 1.96. Yeah, so our market factor obviously is cross-sectionally priced. Yeah, it explains the cross-section of expected returns. Yeah, and if, now you remember when we had the previous approach of the Farmer-Macbeth regressions. Yeah, where we have constant betas, this value was statistically not different from zero. Yeah, we had a t-statistic of 1.25. So next, the t-statistic for the size premium, yeah, which is the third element in our risk premium vector, it's 4.93. So size is priced, okay? Our risk premium for the size factor is 0.18. Yeah, we have seen it's 0.18% per month. And the t-statistic is much larger than 1.96 in our new model. indicating that the size risk factor is priced. Yeah, and so exposure to size explains the differences in cross-sectional returns. Yeah. So smaller firms obviously have on average 0.18% higher expected returns than small stocks. Well, it's actually the average exposure against the measured by the betas. Yeah, you remember we have here betas. We regress the expected returns, average returns on the corresponding exposure against the risk factors. Yeah, so it's different from a time series framework. So next, what about the growth, the value premium then? Yeah, we had last time it was negative, minus 0.64, and we had the statistic of minus 1.87. Yeah, it was statistically not different from zero on a 5% level. So what's going on now? So obviously the value premium is negatively priced. Yeah, it's statistically significantly negatively priced. So which means that those stocks who had that had a higher exposure against the value factor, so which were in essence value stocks, they had lower expected returns. They generated on average lower expected returns than growth stocks. Yeah, which means obviously it is a good choice. Yeah, to be a growth stock if you are a survivor stock in the S&P 500. Yeah, these stocks have obviously been growth stocks. So that was what comes out basically from our analysis, and we see that there are huge differences depending on what Farmer-Macbeth regression you choose. You get different estimates and you come up with different statistical inference. Now, whenever you write your master thesis or you write a paper, I strongly recommend you to use the time-varying beta approach. Yeah, because obviously if we use the other approach that we had discussed earlier, we have very poor we end up with making very poor statistical inference. Yeah, so we need to somehow to address the problem that the betas are time varying, and it makes sense to use then this rolling window approach. But of course, whenever we use this approach, we have to make sure that we have enough time series observations, right? So what is next? So next is, okay, we want to talk about Gartsch modeling. Yeah. So the first task is use the first stock of the data matrix and regress the excess returns on a constant. Take the residuals and estimate an ARCH5 model for the conditional variance. Test if the parameters for the conditional variance equation are statistically significant. So that's what we want to do now. Okay, so our next exercise is then obviously exercise 10, and it is called ARCH models. So let's first, we should get the first stock. We should operate with the first stock on our sample. So our Y on our dependent variable is then defined as, you remember in our Y11 matrix, we have our 25 stocks, the first 25 stocks of our data set, right? So we want to have, want to operate with the first stock. So let's retrieve the first stock and denote it as small y. The length is, of course, the length of y, but we can also write the length of y11. It doesn't matter. And actually, it's already in the workspace, so we don't have to define it. What is our x matrix in this case? Obviously, we already discussed this earlier. It's a vector. It's simply a vector of ones, yeah, a t/1 vector of ones. So we regress our excess returns, yeah, on a vector of ones. That's it. And what we get is, as a point estimator, is just the sample average. Yeah. So beta is equal to x prime x inverted times x prime times y. So, and then u, and then we can, let's just run the code and do that to see what's going on here. So copy this code into MATLAB. What is b? B is 0.81. Yeah. And I told you it should be the sample average of the first stock, right? So what is the sample average of the first stock? It's 0.81. So actually, we can write this, we could make this code much easier, but I just want to show you, you know, how you generally set up this model. Yeah. But once you know what you do, you know, it should be very simple. Next, we get, because we could also here, instead of just a vector of one, we could have here a risk factor model in the mean equation. Yeah, we discussed this extensively on the whiteboard. Yeah, so depending on the regressor matrix here, yeah, you can have here a very large vector, depending on how many regressors you want to account for in the mean equation. But we need the mean equation only in order to get the residuals. Yeah, the residuals have a mean of zero. We know this already by construction. And they are given by our y vector, our egress returns, minus the regressor matrix times beta. Yeah, just the basically what we have here is just the mean. We subtract the mean, like a sample average, from this egress return vector. Yeah, that's what we do, because then we have. We have here on the left hand side a vector that has a mean of zero. Yeah. So next we wanna have this is the mean equation. So next we have the conditional variance, the equation for the conditional variance. So that's obviously the mean equation here. Mean equation. And again, whenever you want to write a note in your code, you have to write this percentage sign. Yeah, MATLAB recognizes that it's not a part of the code. So okay, we have our residuals, and obviously for the conditional, in order to get the formula for our conditional variance, yeah, what do? We regress the lagged squared residuals on the squared residuals. Yeah, it's an autocorrelation model. Yeah, but for the second moment, and we know that we have first to construct the vector of squared residuals. Yeah, let's denote it as u2 is equal with zero. Yeah, and we have t times u's observation, so it's a vector of ones. And what do we store in here? So let's write a for loop. For t is one until capital T, our element in ut, the corresponding element in ut should be the same as in the residual vector, the time congruent element t squared, and the for loop. So let's plug this into MATLAB so that we know what's going on here. To plot u, and we see how u looks like, that's our u, yeah. So we see already from the steering on the residuals that we have periods of very high volatility and periods of very low volatility, and these periods are alternating. But we can see it much better if we take the square residuals. Let's plot the square residuals, plot u2, yeah, this is how it looks like. Yeah. So we see that there is a large degree of volatility clustering going on, and now we have to model it somehow. So next, we know that from our from the derivations on the whiteboard, we have to have a regression for the mean equation now. So let's define our dependent variable, our SY4, and we can choose anything, you know that. So you just have to know what it is. So you can always write here your note, yeah, whatever it is, so that you remember. So when we know if we have a or if we account for five lags in the for the regressors, yeah, in the variance equation, so we lose the first five observations, yeah, because then our dependent variable starts at observation six, yeah. So we have here, we define our dependent variable as the first, as the observations 6 to capital T from our vector of squared residuals. Yeah? So we retrieve the first, the observations 6 to T. So this dimension here of this vector, of this corresponding vector U, Y4 is obviously T minus 5 by 1. Now we have to also define our regressor matrix. Let's give it the name X4. Now we have already so many X's here in our workspace, so it's becomes slightly weird here. So it's we have to have a vector of t minus of the dimension t minus 5 by 1 as a vector of ones in our mean equation in the equation for the variance. And then we have to have lags for this guy here. So the first lag, we can copy it here. The first lag is obviously, it starts at the observation 5, because obviously observation 5 comes 4, 6 in the time dimension. Yeah, and we lose obviously here also one observation in the end. So the next guy, we lag five times. So this is the first lag. The second lag is at a time observation 4, and we lose again one in the end. The next one is then at time 3, and we end up with t minus 3. Yeah, we always have to cut it into pieces. Then we have the next lag would be then 5, 4, 3. It's then 2. And we increase here one number because we lose one more. It's now t minus 4. And the last one, it must be like this, that we have the first observation then here from our U2, which is the vector of squared residuals. Yeah, it must be then the first observation here. And t minus 5 because we lose this 5 observations here from the last regressor. So we end. So we have now defined our regressor matrix for the variance equation, yeah, and we have defined the dependent variable, yeah, which is our conditional sigma square t at time t, yeah. So next we have to get our point estimator beta 4. We want to know what's the exposure, you know, what's the exposure of our lagged squared residual vectors, yeah, what's the impact on the conditional variance, yeah. So we define, we have again our standard OLS formula, yeah, x4 transpose x4 inverted times itself transposed times our y4 vector, yeah. That's now we get the point b4, gives us the point estimator of our variance equation, which has obviously a dimension 6 by 1. Yeah, we have 5 lags of the dependent variable, and we have a vector of 1s. Yeah, the first point estimator gives us the unconditional variance, obviously. Yeah, because it gives us the corresponding average variance if these guys here are 0. If the point estimators would be 0, it's the partial derivatives with respect to the first guy here. So now we have our point estimator, then we have our we need to define our regression residuals. Why do we need those? Because we need to estimate the covariance matrix for our point estimator here for the variance equation. So E4, let's denote the residual vector as E4, and this is also the dimension of this guy is obviously t minus 5 by 1. Yeah, it must be congruent. It has the same dimension as this guy here. Is equal with, obviously, it's y4 minus, surprise, surprise, x4 times beta 4. Now that's the corresponding regression residual for the variance equation. Now let's define our sigma, the variance of this residual vector here for the variance equation as sigma 4, sigma underscore E4, okay, sigma underscore E4, and what and how is it defined? Well, it's 1 over T minus 5 times E4 transposed times itself. Yeah, we know this already. Same formula as we always use. Next, the covariance of this parameter as estimator here for the variance equation is then defined accordingly. It's the covariance of underscore beta 4, and this is then sigma E4, this guy here, times what? Well, times the regressor matrix of the variance equation transposed times itself, inverted, right? That's how it's defined. Let's get the t-statistics as well. So we know we get the t-statistics, we have to square each corresponding element here in this beta 4 vector divided by the square root on the main diagonal of the corresponding covariance matrix. We have done this earlier. So t-stat, let's define a vector of t-statistics for beta 4, and it's a 6x1 vector because we have six point estimates in our parameter vector for the variance equation. And we write a for loop again. For I is running from 1 to 6 because we have 6 estimates. Our t statistics for beta 4 I is defined as give me the element, the corresponding element I in my parameter vector beta 4 and divided by the square root of the corresponding element on the main diagonal, which is element II in the covariance matrix, in the corresponding covariance matrix. So now we have defined everything for our ARCH5 model. Yeah, we have first the Sutter-Mister-Wien equation, and we have here the equation for the conditional variance. Let's copy everything into MATLAB and let's see what we get out of here. Everything seems to work out. So let's plot first let's check our parameter vector. So that's the parameter vector for the variance equation. So we see that the unconditional variance is 28. Yeah, that's the unconditional variance because that's the corresponding variance if the loadings against the lagged squared residuals are zero. Yeah? That's the intercept term of the variance equation. So we see that the first lagged squared variance has a positive impact. So if the lagged squared variance increases by 1 unit, so the volatility in the next period increases by 0.13, obviously. And also the lagged volatility or the lagged squared residual at time t minus 2. If this is positive, the volatility at time t increases by 0.19 in rounded figures. Yeah, we see that obviously the impact somewhat decreases here. Yeah, here it even becomes negative. So at time t minus 4 and t minus 5, yeah, if the residuals, if the squared residuals increase by 1 unit, obviously the volatility at time t is expected to decrease, which doesn't make much of a sense, right? Because obviously, volatility has a positive impact, not a negative impact. So in order to see which of these guys is statistically significant, we have to get the t-statistics. Yeah? So let's retrieve the t-statistics, which is this guy here. Yeah, we just copy it. Don't even have to do it. We could just go here and into the workspace and double-click here the corresponding guy, which is this guy here, but we can also just put it here in and then we get it into the command window instead. So what we see here is that obviously the unconditional variance is statistically significant and the impact of let's get beta 4 into this upper part So here we have it now. So we see that the impact of the first lagged squared residual is positive and statistically significant. Yeah? The point estimate has a t-statistic of 2.89 in rounded figures. Yeah. So there's a statistically significant impact on the past squared residuals on the conditional variance at time t. Yeah. And also for the second point in time, yeah, for the second lag residual, it has a statistically significant impact on the volatility. Yeah, because we see here point estimate is positive for the second lag squared residual, and it's statistically significant because the t statistic is much, much larger than 1.96. Yeah. But next we see that the lag 3, 4, and 5, these guys here, yeah, which have these point estimates, so they are statistically not different from 0. Because we see here, the t-statistic are 1, minus 0.65, and minus 0.69. So these guys here do not seem to have an impact on the volatility. Yeah. So what we see is here, obviously, our model would be well-defined as an ARCH2 model. Yeah, only the first and second legs of the squared residuals have an impact on the conditional variance of that asset. Yeah? So obviously, we do not need always a GARCH model, yeah, which basically summarizes past squared residuals that are far away from yesterday. So obviously this model here works out very well with only two legs. Yeah. So what is our next task then? Now we have run that model. So our next task is, okay, second, explore if negative news have a higher impact on the conditional variance. To do so, estimate a T-ARCH5 model that accounts for a dummy variable indicating negative news at time t minus 1. So, okay, so we have basically the same model, but we have an additional regressor in the variance equation, yeah, that has that captures negative news that arrive at time t minus 1. So, and we want to check if this impact, if this, first of all, is this variable significant? Are negative news, do they have a higher impact than positive news? And if so, is the impact significant? So we know this from financial markets. Usually negative news have a higher impact on the volatility than positive news, right? Because people are afraid and they feel threatened and they sell everything in panic. So now we have to talk about negative news. So how do we model this? First of all, we have to remember now, yeah, we have to remember now that this U2, which starts at observation 5 and goes from until t minus 5. So this is the first regressor here for the in the variance equation, or from the equation for the conditional variance. Yeah, this is the first. This is so to speak the first lag. Yeah, because you remember that our dependent variable, it starts at observation 6 and it goes until t. Our first lag regressor obviously is one period lagged, so it starts at 5 and goes until t minus 1. So, and this is now the corresponding guy. So we have to figure out what is the sign of the corresponding residuals? Yeah. So in the vector u, yeah, because this is the squared vector of residuals u from the mean equation. So we have to figure out where are the negative observations. Yeah. And for those negative observations, we want to formulate a dummy. Yeah. And then we multiply this dummy variable. So we have a dummy variable that has a 1 whenever the corresponding observation in the residual vector u is negative. Yeah. And otherwise it's zero, because then it would indicate positive news. So then we multiply this dummy variable vector of zeros and ones with this guy here and put it here as an additional regressor in the variance equation. So then we have this guy here shows then basically the gives us the impact of positive news, because the second regressor that follows would give us then the impact of negative news. So, or the additional impact of negative news. And this is now what we want to figure out. So how do we proceed? So first of all, we have to ask the question, which of the corresponding residuals in the U vector are negative? Yeah. So, and we want to store them in a dummy variable vector D underscore one, which has zeros of dimension T minus five by one. Yeah. But remember, all of these guys here, dependent variable, and all of these regressors here have dimension T minus five. Yeah. So we have a dummy variable also that has the same dimension. So for T is equal from one until T minus five, what do we want to do? So if the element T is five in the vector U is smaller than zero, so if it's negative, then T should be one. Otherwise, T underscore one T should be zero. And the if command and the for loop. So once again, this guy here, the first element of this vector here, yeah, is the fifth element here, yeah, in the residual vector U. So that's why in this for loop here, when T is one, we go until T plus five. Right, and so on and so forth. So let's create a new regressor matrix now. Yeah, it's noted as U2 underscore bad, which gives us the bad news. Let's just think one more time. So if T is one, so this guy here gives us the observation, the dependent variable starts at observation six, right? And this gives us the observation is at observation five. So we can check this later on as well, one more time. So U2 underscore bad is zeros T minus five by one. So it has the same dimension as this guy here, right? Then for E is equal from one until T minus five, U to bad should be T underscore one at time T times U to T plus five. So it should be actually T plus five minus one, right? Now we end the for loop And this should also be t plus 1 minus t plus 5 minus 1, right? Yeah, because it starts at the first observation here is in position 5. Yeah. And when t is 1 in the first iteration, this observation, we should check the sign of the observation 5. And if t is 1, 1 plus 5 is 6, minus 1 is 5. So we have to subtract here minus 1 in creating the dummy vector here. And also here, yeah, obviously, we have to start the first observation is the fifth observation in our u squared in the vector of squared residuals. So this should be now correct. So next, we change the regression equation. So our x4 so we can just copy it actually. Let's copy it here. And we add here u2 underscore bad, right? This is now the additional regressor. Let's just run here, and we have to define here, we should not forget the index t, yeah? So now it should be correct. Let's just check it. Let's just copy this code into MATLAB. Yeah. Let's check how it looks like. What's the dimension? We go to the workspace and check d underscore here. Yeah. And we also check this guy here, MATLAB. Yeah, so it's better to, obviously, you see, it's better to have here, don't forget the comma here, otherwise MATLAB spits you out what it is. So now we have constructed our X4 matrix. Let's check the dimension also from Y4. What's the dimension of Y4? Yeah, it has the correct dimension, 492. And our dummy vector, it has the same dimension. So this should be correct. Okay, we have now defined our new regressor matrix. The vector of our dependent variable is the same. So this obviously doesn't change. So now we can just copy also this guy here. We can copy the rest of the code as well. We just have to make some small additions. So beta is now overwritten, beta 4 is overwritten. This is also overwritten. Beta is now obviously a 7x1 vector. Yeah, this is overwritten. This is overwritten. This as well. And this becomes now a 7. We have now 7 values in our t-statistic vector. So this goes until 7. Okay, we can now just copy everything. Into our command window and paste it in. So now let's get the point estimator beta 4. So this is how it looks like. Yeah, this is how it looks like. So the unconditional variance is now 24. It's 24. And we have here the point estimator for the positive news, yeah, for the negative news, and for the news at time t minus 2 for the squared residuals of time of the second leg. And we have here the impact of the squared residuals for leg 3, leg 4, and leg 5. Yeah? Once again, this is for the first leg when it's positive. This is for the first leg when it's negative. This is for the second leg. Yeah, for the third leg, fourth, and fifth. Now we have to get the corresponding t-statistics. Yeah, what are the corresponding t-statistics? We have to go, we can go here. Let's go to t-stats, beta 4. So what we see is a very interesting picture, obviously. So we see that the intercept term, which measures the unconditional variance, is still significant. The t-statistic is 5.12, which is much larger than 1.96, indicating statistical significance on any level. Yeah. So once we control for negative news, yeah, which is given by this point estimator, 0.47, yeah, because we see in our regressor matrix, the third element here is measuring the bad news that arrive at time t minus 2, at time t minus 1, yeah. So it has a point estimate of 0.47, and the t-statistic indicates statistical significance on any level, because the corresponding t-statistic is 6, which is much larger than 1.96. We see that once we control for bad news at time t minus 1 arriving, then we see that the positive news becomes statistically not different from 0. So positive news, obviously, once we control for negative news, positive news have no impact on the conditional variance. Yeah? So it's only negative news, obviously, that matter, that arrive at time t minus 1. Next, the lagged squared residuals at time t minus 2, which are given here by this point estimator of 0.17, yeah, have a t-statistic of 3.88, which indicates that the squared residuals at time t minus 2 have a significant impact on the variance, and the impact is positive. Yeah? It's positive 0.17, obviously. Then also at lag t minus 3, the point estimator, obviously, the more we go into the past, yeah, the less is the impact on the variance, because you see here, it decreases linearly from 0.47 to 0.17 and to 0.09. But what we see is still the third lag is in this model, obviously, has a significant impact on the conditional variance, because the t-statistic is larger than 1.96. Yeah, it's 2.08 in rounded figures. So now in this model here, once we control for negative news at time t minus 1, we see that the model suggests that even the third lag, yeah, so this, the regression, the squared residuals at time t minus 3 have a positive impact on the conditional variance at time t. And still, like in the earlier model, we see that the point estimator for the fourth and for the fifth leg, they are negative, yeah, which is obviously doesn't make much of a sense for a variance equation. But also we see here from the t-statistics that these guys are statistically not different from 0. Yeah? So we can basically re-estimate this model without these guys here. So that's basically for a T-arch model, threshold arch model. Yeah. So we see this model is well defined with three legs, and obviously a dummy variable that gives us the negative negative news basically. And you can play around with many different model variations. Yeah. So people, you can play around with the Scarf models the whole day. So there are many different model variations that you can make use of. So next, what is next? So now we are clear with this guy here. So let us explore causality invariance. To do so, investigate if the conditional variance of the second stock in the sample has an impact on the conditional variance of the first stock. Use five legs of the regression residuals in the second stock of the second stock in the equation for the conditional variance of the first stock, which is controlled for arch 5 effects, and test whether the corresponding point estimates are statistically significant. What do you conclude? So obviously, now we have the topic causality and variance. Now we want to see if the volatility of another stock, which is in this case the second stock, increases, does it have an effect on the conditional variance of the first stock? Yeah. So obviously we can copy quite much of the code. We have now the topic causality and variance. Have two mean equations. So we have the first mean equation from the first asset here. We can just copy it. And we have, of course, also a mean equation for the second asset. Equation one, mean equation two. So our y, let's call it, we have now so many y's already. Let's define it as y4. Okay. So y4. Then the second asset length is the same. T, we have already defined T. T is the same. We don't need to define it again. Our X matrix is the same because we have just a vector of ones that we are interested in. Now we have here this Y4 and our U. Let's call it U8 because we have also already so many U's here in our equations. Is U4 minus, let's call this as B8, okay, that we don't get confused here. This is then U8 is then Y4, which is the excess return vector of the second asset in our matrix Y11, minus the vector of ones, yeah, which we have already defined earlier, minus times the corresponding parameter vector, which is in essence just the sample average of this guy here. So then we have defined the regression residuals. Now we have to define the squared residuals for the second asset. It's defined as U2_2, which is defined, it has the same length, it's let's create a zero vector of ones where we store in the squared residual to each point in time. Use again a for loop. For t is 1 to capital T, our U2_2 at time t should be U8 at time t squared. And this for loop here, that's it. So next. So the dependent variable for the variance equation is the same like before. Yeah, it's namely, it's the squared guy from this equation, which we have already defined earlier. So we can just copy it. We have it still in the workspace, right? So we can just go back and it's this guy here. Yeah, for the first equation. So we know it's U2 and it's still in our workspace. So our YY is simply U2, and we take again the observations 6 until capital T. Yeah. So we have to define now our regressor matrix. I define it now as X, let's call it X5. We can call it, as I told you already, however, you just have to remember what it is. Yeah. So make your own notes then. So just copy from the first exercise here, the X4 matrix, and just copy it here. That's it. And so we have now here, obviously, the corresponding lags of our dependent variable. Yeah. like in the first exercise, yeah, it's still the same. You see it here, yeah. And now we have to add the corresponding squared residual vectors for the congruent time dimension here. Yeah? We want to have 5 legs for the second asset. So, and because it doesn't fit into the same row, we have to, if we write 3 dots here in MATLAB, it recognizes, okay, we continue the comment in the next row. Yeah, that's it. So now we want to have also, let's copy these guys here into the next row. And now we can just write here u2_2, because we have already defined it here, what it is, right? It's the squared residual, the squared regression residual for the second asset, yeah, here. We have the mean equation for the second asset, we have the corresponding regression residuals for the second asset, and we square them and store them into this u_2 vector, yeah? And we take the time congruent component from that vector, yeah, like we have for the asset itself, yeah? So let's add here the corresponding components, lagged squared residual vectors from the second asset. So now we have defined our regressor matrix for the variance equation. For the variance equation for the first asset, yeah, this is now important to have in mind. So our parameter vector B5 is then given by X5 transpose times X5 inverted times X5 transposed times our vector y, which is actually we don't even have to write y, we can just grab this guy here. Okay. We don't even have to define this. Doesn't matter. Then we have to have, so now we have the point estimates, right? But now we also want to know the corresponding t statistics, because we want to test. We want to see if there is causality in variance. Yeah, does the if the uncertainty or if the volatility of the second asset increases, does this have an increase, or does an increase in past volatility of the second asset, does it have an impact on the current volatility of the first asset? Is there some of the spillover in volatility going on? This is what we're interested in. So now that's why we have to estimate also the corresponding covariance matrix of that point estimator here for the variance equation. Let's denote the regression residuals of that of this variance equation as E5, and they are given by what? By this guy here, which is our dependent variable, minus X5 times the parameter vector beta 5, yeah? So then the sigma, the corresponding sigma from E5, then defined as what? It's 1 over t minus 5 times what? Well, E5 transposed, surprise, surprise, times E5. That's the variance of the residuals from the variance equation. Okay, it sounds a little bit awkward, but it is what it is. Then we have the covariance of the parameter vector beta 5 is given by, well, the corresponding residual variance sigma_E5 times what? Times X5 transposed times X5 inverted. Yeah, our standard formula. Then we have a vector of, we want to get the t-statistic, so the t-statistic for the vector beta 5 is defined as zeros, and now we have 11. It's an 11 by 1 vector. Why? Because we have an intercept term here, yeah, and we have 5 legs of squared residuals from the first asset, from the asset itself, and in addition to that, we have 5 more regressors, yeah, which are the squared leg residuals of order 5 from the second asset. Yeah, so that's why our t-statistic vector has the dimension 11 by 5. So for I, is running from 1 to 11, do what? So our t statistic for beta 5 is given by take the corresponding value of the beta 5 vector, which is the corresponding element I, and divide it by the square root of what? Of the covariance matrix on that vector, and take the element II, yeah, on the main diagonal. So that's it. See if we have, yeah, we have closed all parentheses here. That's good. So we can now just copy the code. Into MATLAB, do it, paste it. So let's check the point estimator, beta 5. So we see here, obviously, we see that the first six elements, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So these are the corresponding guys, yeah, the corresponding legs from the first asset. So we see the intercept term is 27, which is the unconditional variance, and we see that the for the first squared leg residual, yeah, the exposure is positive. So the first, second, and third leg squared residuals from the first asset appear to have a positive impact on the conditional variance at time t for the first of the first asset, whereas the fourth and the fifth leg, we know this already from earlier analysis, seem to have a negative impact, but probably it's insignificant even now in this model. We see from the second asset, so we see here the point estimate is positive for the first leg squared residual, yeah, we see these guys here are negative, yeah, and the fourth and fifth squared residuals seem to have also a positive impact. But this doesn't tell us much. Yeah? These are just the point estimates. We need to check the t-statistics. Yeah, what are the t-statistics? We find it here. So we see, obviously, that the first 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we see again, so like in earlier, like in the first model, we see that the intercept is statistically significant. Yeah. So which means the unconditional variance here is positive. Yeah, statistically significantly positive because the t statistic is larger than 1.96. We see also that the first leg and the second leg have a statistically significantly positive impact on the variance of the first asset at time t. Yeah, so whenever the residual increases, whenever the squared residual at time t minus 1 or time t minus t minus 2 increase, this has a positive effect on the current volatility of the first asset. We see that leg 3, 4, and 5, the t-statistics are below 1.96. Or we see actually that the residual at time minus 3 is statistically not different from 0, and at time minus 4 seem to have a negative effect. Let's see what's the point estimator. It's minus 0.14. Yeah. So we see that this guy here seems to be statistically significant, negative. So whenever the squared residual at time t minus 4 is positive, the variance or the impact on the current variance or conditional variance is negative. It doesn't make much of a sense, actually. What we see also, if we now check the last five components, which give us the impact of the lag squared residuals from the second asset on the conditional variance of the first asset. We see that the first point estimator, which is 0.01, or in rounded figures, it's 0.02, is positive and statistically significantly positive. The t-statistic is 3.97 in rounded figures, and the corresponding point estimate is 0.02 in rounded figures. So the impact is in economic magnitude much less than the time congruent impact from the first leg of the squared residual from the asset itself, because the impact is 0.12 in rounded figures. Yeah, so it's only 1/6 basically from the impact of the lagged squared residual at time t minus 1 from the asset itself. Yeah, but we see still the impact seems to be statistically significant. Yeah, on any level, whereas all the other lags here, lags 2 to 5, don't have to have any impact. Yeah, so these guys here, the point estimator, are statistically not different from zero. So which means that higher lag orders, yeah, of the squared residuals, yeah, from the second asset, do not seem to have an impact on the conditional variance of the first asset, right? So we could run basically a restricted model, yeah, that has just one leg for the first asset, for the second asset, and 4 legs for the first asset, yeah, and then probably this guy here will turn out to be statistically insignificant, yeah. But this is something that you can do at home. This is basically how you would in an ARCH framework test for causality invariance, right? So actually what you would do is you would implement a wall test. Yeah, you would test these parameters here simultaneously. But since we know that one of these guys is highly significant, yeah, we know that a wall test would also reject the null hypothesis that these guys here are jointly zero. Yeah, so because one of these guys is highly significant already.